Bem. Today, everyone, today I will start the first lesson for the module 2 that is about the C functions. Just tell you that I would like to say that C function is very important in C programming, right? Let's think like this. If you want to start a C program, right, you have to start from the main function, right? You may start with the integer main, void, or void main, right? For the case of void main, you don't have to return anything. But for integer main, you have to return something, right? An integer. For example, you can return 0 or return 1. That might be your question from the beginning of this class, right? Why do we have to put integer, or why do we have to put void, right? Or today you will know the reason why we will use void main or why we use int main. I would like to say that main is a function, is also a function, and C compiler will treat the main function as the first function that will be executed or invoked, right? So today we will talk about how to write a function. And also we have to show you some examples of the math library functions that you might have found before. For example, if you want to use the square root, or if you want to use absolute, right, you have to use the math function by including it from the math.h. Or sometimes you might want to use the random number generation function, right? So you might have to use the random and random seed, right, in order to randomize and a real number, right, from 0 to 1, right? And the last one, the last topic that is very important as well, right? We will talk about the passing argument, right? When you use a function, you can pass many arguments as you want, but different kinds of arguments you might have to study today. There are two kinds of parameters or arguments that you might have to use. That is the pass by values and pass by pointer or pass by references, right? That the things that you have to study today. So then we will have to first introduce about the why do we have to use function. That things like this, when we want to write a program, C program, right? If you want to write a small or simple program, right? You don't have to separate into a set of functions, right? I would say like this, if you want to write a C program is treated as a set of function, a set of function, many functions, right? C program is a set of functions, right? So, but in the real world application, I would say that the real world problems or the real world application must be larger and more complicated. So what you have to do is you might have to use the top-down approach in order to solve the problem of the real world problems. What does it mean by top-down approach? You have to subdivide the problem or the complex problem. Suppose we have a problem, you have to a problem. And you have to subdivide it into a smaller sub problems, right? This is the way that you will tackle a problem, right? So this kind of the problem you call top-down design, as its name, right? You can design a program in terms of the top-down design. As it name, right, you have to start from the top, right, of the problem. That is a problem, the main problem, and then you have to subdivide it into the smaller problems, right? This we call the top down approach, or sometimes we can call it as a modularized. Modularized will be treated in the strategy of divide and control. Divide means you have to subdivide the problem into a smaller sub problems. And then you have to control each sub problems. Sometimes we don't call this as problems. We'll call a program, right? a program can be subdivided into many sub program. Sometimes we can call sub function as a sub programs. Okay, function can be okay. Sometimes we call function. Sometimes we will call sub program. Right. I would like to say that it is similar things, but there are some difference in terms of function and the term of subprogram. I will show you later. So in this case, right, for the top-down approach or modularization, it is easier to track smaller problems or smaller modules, right? For example, if you have a big and larger complex problem, if you subdivide into a smaller problem and then you try to tackle this for the solution of the problem, the smaller problem, it will be easier. So this is the reason why we have to separate a C program into a set of functions. That is the main idea of the topic that we will talk today. So inside of the function, we have the repeated set of the statement. Or I would say that suppose we have a main function, and then in main function, we have many similar statement, and it could be grouped into the same group, right? Into the same group. When we put this like this in the main function, it will be long, a long function, main function. So in order to solve this problem, maybe we have to separate this one into a function, right? We have to write it in a separate function, and then we can call the function instead. I'm going to talk about this later. Okay, up to now, do you have any questions? Okay, if you don't have any question, I would like to show you a simple program. If you want to find an area and the circumference of a circle, right? If you have a circle, you want to find the area and the circumference of the circle, what shall we do? The first thing is that you have to get the circle radius, right? You have to get the radius first. Okay, this is the first thing that you have to do. So sometimes we can call this one is input. And if you want to calculate for the area, you have to use pi r square, right? So you have to convert into the C program function. Oh, sorry, C program statement. So you can use pi multiplied by radius, right? In order to avoid the pow function. Right. If you want to use a power function, you may have to include math.h. Okay, before we use pi, right? Pi can be defined as a constant, right? Define pi, right? You can write like this, define pi, right? You can see that pi is capitalized. Right? Each character will be capitalized, and then 3.414159. will be the constant of this pi number. Or we can treat this pi number as a constant. But for the case, the main difference from the definition of the define or the constant will be, pi will be substitute any places of pi with this value. For this example, when you are trying to compile this program, pi will be substituted with 3.14159, any place of pi. Also, this place, if you want to find the circumference of a circle, right, you can use 2πr, right, 2πr. So when you define pi like this, when you compile this program, 3.1415 will be substituted into this pi, and then you can print it out, the area and the circumference of the circle. And then this one, right, because main here is divided as integer main void, right? Void means no argument here. You want to specify there is no argument here, but this function main will return integer value, This is a return type. Return type. So if you have a return type integer, you have to end up with this function by return something. In this case, we return zero. Zero means normal program termination. This is tradition. The tradition for this one is normal program termination. Normal program termination, right? We will return zero. This is tradition. This is a tradition. Okay. What's wrong with this program? What's wrong with this program? There is nothing wrong, right? You can compute the area and the circumference of a circle by this program, no problem, right? Okay. Okay, if you want to find to compute the rim area of the flat washer, right? You have to circle. You want to find the area of the circle, so you have to use the pi r square, right? For the outer circle minus the inner circle area, right? So you can use this program or this formula, right? So this is not a problem. Right? Okay, but what is the problem with this program? Let's think like this. If you want to find the not just the area of this circle, or of just only one circle, you may have many radius, right? So what you have to do is you have to copy this program to below and then copy program, right? So this doesn't make sense. So in order to make the program shorter, you may have to make the use of functions. This is the main advantage of using function. Okay, let's go to why and how we will separate into the function. Okay, for this program, right? This one want to show you how to compute the width of batch of a flat washer, right? So you may have to define many variables here and then get many parameters and then try to find many value, right? Compute the rim area and so on, right? You will find that this program is quite long, but it's okay, right? This is quite long, but the main problem is that you might have to calculate for the area, right? The area of the washer, right? Two times, right? Compute the area, compute the width, right? Many times, right? So in order to avoid the duplication, you may have to use a function in order to reduce the number of the duplications. Okay, so here we come to the functions. How can we define or declare a function? First of all, you have to know the name, or you have to name the function name, right? And in order, we have to start why first. Why do we have to use function? Why? First of all, the function will allow us to modularize a program, to make a program into a smaller module, right? We will start from program, right? And this one will be the modules, module one, module two, and so on, right? This one, modularize a program and then reuse the code, right? And there are two types of the function, right? Programmer user, right? So we can call the programmer defined function. And we also have the prepackaged function that is sometimes we call the built-in function. Sometimes I call it built-in function. So this function, for example, is random, right? Random or square root, right? Or absolute, right? They are defined in the predefined C standard library. And in function, we have to specify the input variables. We can call arguments, and we can also have the output value that is which is return debt. And the last one, it will be the function body. Okay, so it could be return or drawn in terms of the block, back block like this, input and process or function and then output, right? This is the illustration of function, input, process, and output. Okay, so let's go to the function. So for the function, right, function, what does it mean by the function? So here we come to what is a function? Function is a statement defining the functions are written only once and the statement are hidden from other functions. Function can be invoked by a function call, which specifies the function name and provides information as an argument that call the function needs to perform its designated task. What does it mean by that? For a function, right, you can define function like this. For example, if I want to find square, function square, so I name it square, like this, SQR. Or maybe we have the SQR as a built-in function, we will define square as user-defined function. And if we want to use this square for just return the integer value or only. So inside the square, we may have the argument or function to get only integer, right? Size or width of this square, right? This is a size, right? Size length. So in this function, we can define like this. This is similar to the main function where we have to start with the integer, which is the return value. And this one is the name. The name, square is the name of the function. And this one will be called as the argument. In this function, there is only one argument, and we can also define many arguments as you like, but it has to be finite number of arguments. In this example, only one argument here. Okay, understand that? And for function, there are two kinds of function, right? The first one is function. Function will return integer or double or any primitive data type. But we can also think of function as the no return function. I will call it as the subprogram. Subprogram will not return anything, so I will define it as a void. Void and okay, I will name it as subprogram. Subprogram will return nothing, right? And it could be okay, int n1, int n2, right? So in this case, we have two arguments, n1 and n2. And then there is no return value. So that's why I use this void to specify that this is a special function with no return, no return value. Okay, so now we have two kinds of function. The first one, function as a function. Function as a function, we have to define the return value, int or double or character, anything, right? But for another kinds of function, we can call it as a subprogram, right? It can be void, right? You have to specify the return value as a void. Y means no return value or value type. Okay, up to now, do you have any question? Okay, if you have no question, I will go to the modularizing program. Modularizing program means if you want to, okay, to subdivide. Okay, when we have maybe we have to match with the real world application, that is the company hierarchy, right? For example, if you have a boss and boss has three workers, right? So it has to be written in terms of the hierarchical management like this, right? So this is similar to the case of the program or function. Program will be subdivided into many functions. For example, this might be three functions. And this function, we may call two functions and so on, right? So it will be like in the real world application that a boss will call function or function callers to the worker, right? They will ask the worker to do something for him, right? So this is why we call the function. And the worker one can call someone else to do something for himself as well. So that's why we call this worker one, we call worker four and worker five to work for him. After worker four finish the things, they will return something to tell the worker that this function has been finished and then return something. If return something, it will be the function. If return nothing, that will be sub-program. So in this example, right, function call from the worker one will call worker four and worker five to do something for his for him, right? And for the boss, right, boss will call worker one to do and worker two to work, worker three to perform something, right? This is what we call the modularized program, right? This is similar to the case of the function call. But once again, when you call function, it has to be step by step. It has to be step by step. For example, worker one has to be finished, then the worker two will be invoked, okay, will be executed. Okay, we have already talked about the function and how to write the functions. So it might be easier if I start from the program or to write the program to show you the how function will do, right? Okay, maybe I will show you how to write a program. Can you see my screen? You can see my screen, right? Okay, so I'm trying to write a program to show you the function. For this example, right, I will start from the main program, right? In this main program, right, we have integer, right? Integer means return value. And then if I would like to specify, there is no argument, I use void here. So in this, the main function here is also a function, a kind of function. Okay, then I write a hello world and then return zero. Why do we have to return zero? To show you that this program will be normal program termination. Right. Termination, okay. So in this program, I would like to show you the how to write a square. Right. Okay. If you have main program, that should be started first when you compile the program. And then I have program integer square, right? I would like to define my the user define that square, right? I use square, right? It will be start with a small letter, right? And for the square, right, I would like to get integer with that is the length of the square, W-I-D-T-H, integer width. Okay, I always write a program like this, right? I always use the braces right after the name. Why do I have to write a square? Because I want to show that this function is the function for return a value of the square root, value of something. For example, if I get square two, okay, square two, it will return four, something like this, okay, something like this, okay. So inside the square, right, I can write a program, for example, return, okay, this is a simple program, return with multiply by with. okay, I write a program like this and then square here. So I would like to print square. So I hello world and then percent sign D function, hello world function. Okay, hello world function. So using this function, it could be like treated as a value. So I put square 2 here. Square 2 here will return integer and integer. So I would like to print it percent sign D like this. So I can use this one. And I can also use like this integer x is equal to square 2. Okay, I can also use like this and then print x. Okay, I try to use two kinds, right? X and square 2. We can use both of them, right? We can specify x first by calculate the square here, or we can use function square 2 directly. Okay, maybe square 2 is too simple. Then I use 12. Okay, then I run it. Okay, so you can see from this warning, this is my intention, right? To get this warning. To say, oh, warning function declaration. Why? Why they don't know square? This one, if you say square, but it's just warning, right? In this program compiler, this compiler will still run the program hello world function 144 is equal to 144. That is the result from the square 12, right? Why? Anyone in this room can tell me why the warning show like this? Okay, up to now, right? You know that if you are trying to study the C programming here, not just only you have to study about how to code program, you have to know how to debug the program as well. And also you have to think about the test case as well. You might have seen these skills, right, in the module one examination, that you have to know how to get the test case in order to pass the program evaluation. Manula. Okay, Manula. It execute main function first. That is right. It execute main function first. That is common. Okay. Nan part, you said that you are trying to say that the function is below, right? Below the main. Anything else you want to tell me more? I have to say that this program can be executed for one compiler, but for some compilers, it could not be executed. That's what and why. Yes. In order to solve this problem, Nanpat said that this function is below and main function is upper. The main tactic of C program is that if you want to use square, you have to define first. Once again, if you use square inside the main function, you have to define this first. So you have to move, the simplest way to do is you have to move square before main. So while the program is compiling, right, it will start from square, right? Square will be known first and then main function. So in this way, there is no warning. Okay, when I run this program, there is no warning. The program execution compile and execute normally. Okay, the reason is that the program doesn't know in advance what does it mean by square. If you do like this, So you have two solutions. First, you have to put the square function right before the main function. Or if you don't want to write the program like this because the main function will be executed first, you want the main function will be the first thing that you have to know, you have to write. So you have to move this, but you have to write what we call program prototype. If you want to put square right behind the main function, you have to write a program prototype, right? By writing, you just simply copy integer square and here, right? Only the head of the program to here and then semicolon. You can write like this. This one will show that the function square will return integer and integer value, and there is just only one argument. Okay, this is an argument. There is only one argument here. Okay, because the program just to know the number of arguments and also the function name and also the return type, why do we have to specify the prototype here? Because inside the main function, right, you define square. If you don't define the prototype here, you don't know the return type of the square. Okay, so the compilation will be error. And you don't know the number of arguments as well. If you use the square first, there is no prototype here. So the program might cause the error. So that's why we have to move the function before the main, or you have to write the program prototype. Understand? If you understand, please press 5 to the chat so I know that you still follow me. Okay, I copy this program into onto the chat. Okay, so you don't have to type. Okay, easy, right? Easy. One thing that I would like to remind you, because writing a function, you have to name it as its name or as its duty. The function name should be correspond to your intention. For example, if you want to write a function to compute the square, right? You have to name it square, not area, or not the circumference. Okay, so this is the thing that I have to remind you. So similar to the case of the module examination, you have to name the function as well. Even you can also compile it, you can run it correctly. But in terms of the manner, the good manner of writing, of program writing, you have to name it as its name. Okay, so this is the one that I would like to remind you. Okay, this is the function, the simple function, the first function that I would like to show you. And okay, there is an example of function to find the maximum from three arguments. Okay, let me. I want to find the maximum value among three arguments. Maximum integer x, integer y, and integer z, right? Okay. How can I find the maximum value? Integer max, okay, and then I want to print out maximum value. Maximum value is so I like maximum value, right? 12, 24, 18, right? Okay. Anyone can help me here to write a program to find the maximum value? So in this way, if you want to put the main function declaration or the maximum function declaration here, I have to write the program prototypes here. I can also write integer with no argument. There is no problem with this. Okay, so let's go to the maximum. So first of all, I have to check whether if x is greater than y, right? Then what? Then check if x is greater than z, right? Then return x, right? So this one, x is the maximum value. Otherwise, return z, am I right? And in this case, if x is less or greater than y, else mean y is greater than x. So we have to check for if, right? If y is greater than z, in this case, y is greater than x, right? Return y, else return z. Okay, so this is the to find the maximum value among three values. Okay, so then I try to run this program. Run. Maximum value is 24. Okay, that is correct, right? This is. Okay. So this is an example of how to. In this case, like you don't have to put the braces, no problem, because we have only one statement here. If x greater than z, right? So return x, else return what? Return z. Okay. But I want to, okay, to make this program clean, right? So I normally use the braces in order to use it together with the if clause. Okay. Okay, we have the maximum value. And then in my lecture or in my PowerPoint, right, there is a function that to write a function to calculate for the area of the washer. So you can, or in the lab in this afternoon, or you have time after that, you can also try to write the program, try to practice. Okay. And inside the my lecture note, right, there are some math library functions that you can also use. If you want to find square root, you don't have to write a program by yourself. You can use the math library. Absolute, exponential function, or logarithmic, right? Both for the natural logarithm and logarithm for base 10, right? You can also use this one. And if you want to find the absolute value for the floating point value, you can use f absolute. FABS, right, and ceiling. Okay, you can try to write a program in order to prove that you know the math library function. Okay, and also we provide you the some random generating function, right, to write the code for the random number, right? Why do we have to use a random number generation? Okay, let me show you this. Okay. Up to now, you know how to write a function, right? I would like to say that the function here, you will return something, right? For this example, you want to find the maximum value among these three numbers. You can use maximum and return integer value. You can also change integer to double. You can also change integer to floating point if your number is floating point or double. Okay, so what, anything else? Okay, in the lab, right, I asked you to find to convert from the degree Celsius to Fahrenheit and Fahrenheit to degree Celsius, right? So you may have to use or to name the function as its name. For example, if you want to convert from degree Celsius to Fahrenheit, you might have to name the function like this. Okay, double. I suggest you, if you want to use the real number or the floating point value, I suggest you to use double. Just in case that the number is too big or too small, right? The number, the data type double will cover for this. Okay, so if you want to convert, so you have to start for the function, it is a tradition. You have to start with the lower case character, convert. I write convert. Convert degree Celsius. So you can see that if I start with the next word, I will use the capital letter in order to separate the word by word, convert degree Celsius into I use two and then Fahrenheit. Okay, maybe this function name is very long, right? But it makes sense. Okay, because you will know in advance from the name, right? There is the function to convert from degree Celsius to Fahrenheit. Okay, and then you have to get what is the input for the degree Celsius. Okay, you can use double and Celsius, like this. Okay, do you get it? What is a function to calculate? Okay, maybe I will start from double degree Celsius. Okay, I want to write a program function. Hello world. Okay, for the enter a degree Celsius. Second F. Don't forget ampersand here. Percent sign F, right? Okay, you can get enter a degree Celsius and then the degree in Fahrenheit is okay. So you will show convert. You can use convert degree Celsius to Fahrenheit and then what is the input? Degree Celsius. Okay, even if this function is very long, right? But once again, you can know, oh, okay, inside this main function, you know that you try to get the degree Celsius first as an input and then the output will print the degree in Fahrenheit, right? How can I get that? You use the function convert degree Celsius to Fahrenheit like this. And then there is just only one input degree Celsius here. Okay. Inside this degree Celsius, I can return. So inside a function, you can use return only. That is, there is no problem. So how can I calculate convert from Celsius to Fahrenheit? Do you remember the formula? Okay, let me, maybe I want to try to test the program. I return 100. Okay, run. Percent sign F. So Celsius will be Fahrenheit minus 30. Why I cannot use this one? Warning format F expect for my argument is double LF. Okay. Forget to write the product height. Convert degree Celsius. Okay, enter a degree Celsius. So 25 degree Celsius is low. Why? Celsius plus. To be LF. So 25 degrees Celsius or degree Fahrenheit is 77. Function return double. Okay, because okay, I will say like this. From the previous function, right? Because we use integer and we also return the integer value as well. So for the C compiler, it will expect the function to return integer by default. Once again, in C programming, C compiler will expect the return value for the function to be integer value by default. So just in case that you return double, and it found out later that the function will return double, but you forget to define the function prototype, it will be, I would say function prototype, it would be cause an error. You can see that there are a very big error like this, okay? I see, warning, even it's warning, but you have to be careful about that. The warning is like this because the program compiler will expect convert degree Celsius to Fahrenheit to be an integer, but it found out later that this is a double. So the program can be compiled, but it will cause some error. Okay, many errors, I would say that. Too many errors, right? Okay, so once when I change this to write a function prototype and then I run. So the program will run perfectly. Okay, so just to be careful about this. And I don't think the result is quite simple. 77 is too simple. I think there is something wrong. There's supposed to be 77 something, right? I think it costs like this. Because you use Celsius multiplied by 9 divided by 5, this would be the many integers by integer calculation by default. And Celsius here is double. So I would like to force it to return double value. So I can use, we call this casting double. It means that the calculation here will return the double value or the floating point value. So I cast it to be double. Still 70. 25 divided by 5 is 5. Okay, this one is divisible. Maybe I use 26. Okay, we have the double value here. Achan, what does percent sign 5.2f means? Thank you for your question. I've already taught you about this, right? It means that we are going to print out floating point value with five columns. With five columns. I will say like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 columns. And I would like to reserve for the decimal value for two digits. So this one will be dot. And then it will be XX. That is a digit. Okay, for XX, I use 99 to represent the digit right after the decimal point here. There are two digits right after the point. This is why we call 5.2. And we reserve the space for five characters. So in this case, this will reserve five characters here. Okay, if I want to use it more than that, I will use 10. Okay, 10. 10 will reserve here more, 5 more, 2, 3, 4, 5, like this. Okay, let me show you the program. 26. And then you can see that here, we will reserve for 10 characters here. And 2 reserve for this decimal and 1 reserve for decimal point. Do you get the point? Okay. There is a secret chat that sent to me and then I tell you all. Okay. I hope you all get the idea of how to write a function. It's pretty easy, right? And now we have what time is it now? It is 11:30. Okay, so I will have you to have a 10-minute break and then I will come back to teach you again. Okay, you can go to the restroom and then we come back in 10 minutes. Thank you. Okay, the next thing is that I would like to, okay, before the previous function, I can call it as a pass by value. Because when you pass a value and then you return just one value for the return type, it can be called that function is the pass by value. But sometimes if you want to return more than one value, you can use pass by reference. So in this case, I want to use the example of the radius. I use pi, right? Define pi. Pi is t.419. okay, this is pi, right? And if I want to find the area of this circle is okay, area is pi r square, right? Pi multiplied by radius. Okay, so I can run this program. Right? Suppose I use radius 5.2. Okay, the area is 84.95, right? And circumference is 2 pi r. Circumference of this two pi r. Okay, normally we can use like this, right? Okay, you can get the area and the circumference. Okay, this is the normal. I can say normal. The normal way to do. But if we use function, we may have to, okay, double area of circle, right, radius. If I define this, right, I use return pi r, I write like this, semicolon, and then I print out area. Area radius. Okay, and I want to find circumference. Circumference, okay. Circumference is 2 multiplied by pi r. Okay, I can also use this function, these two functions, in order to solve this one. Okay, so okay, the result is, the result are exactly the same. Okay, but, okay, you have to use separate function. Sometimes maybe you want to use the subprogram to return. So I use void to calculate for calculate or compute area and circumference. So, okay, I use double. Double will be get the input radius, and I want to return the value double area. And this is the new things, okay? I get the input, the first argument is the radius, which is the input, and I want to return the value will be the result, two result from this compute area and circumference, right? Area. So we have double and circumference. Okay. So then I use this function. So this one will be what we call subprogram. Subprogram means function with no return value. Okay, with no return value. So we don't have to return anything. Okay, and we can, in main function, I can use this one, compute area circle like this. And then input will be radius and result will be area. Okay, I use area 2, right? And circumference 2, right? To distinguish between the function area and function circumference here. Okay, I use area 2 and circle 2. And then I have to define area 2 and circumference 2 will be the output here. Okay, output here. So this one, when I write like this, okay, this will be the technique. And area is equal to pi r square. So I copy to here. Do you follow me? And then I also copy circumference is equal to 2 pi r. Okay. And then I try to print out area 2. And circumference 2. Remember one thing, right? When I try to, when I ask you if you want to print out something, area 2 and circumference 2 will be two input or two outputs. If it will be declared as the output, so I ask you to initialize it every time. Okay, so I separately like program double here. These two values will be output. In order to avoid the print out of the garbage. Okay, let me try to print out like this. Okay. You can see that this print out 0.0 and this print out 0.0. Why? Because this one, even we didn't declare it, we didn't initialize it to be any value, but in this C compiler, it initialized it to be 0.0 for both area 2 and circumference. But if I initialize it to be 1.0, and this one will be 1.0, and then I run the program 5.4. Okay, the result is the same as its initialization, as their initialization, because we initialize area 2 and 1 to be 1.0 and circumference 2 to be 1.0. And then once we call this function, and then radius will be bound to R. And then will be compute for the area and circumference. In fact, maybe you think, ideally, you may think that the result will return to this area and this circumference, right? But it didn't, right? This one, area 2 and circumference 2, didn't change anything. Any value has been changed, has not been changed. So in order to make this happen, to change the value as this area here, we will use what we call by, pass by reference. Okay, look here carefully. Normally you will like this, we call by value or pass by value. So when you pass this one as area is 1, circumference is 1, even you change the value of area and circumference in this function. But when the value, when the function call back to this function, so this still to be 1.0 and 1.0. But if you want to make this change to be the same as the previous result, so what you have to do is you have to put asterisk here. To make it to be passed by reference, and this one, you have to, this one, you have to use ampersand. Like in scanf, right? That's why scanf, you use ampersand here. This one, you use ampersand here as well. Okay? And then this one, right? When you use ampersand here, okay, the actual meaning of ampersand here is to send the address of area 2. Address of area 2 and circumference 2. Not the area itself. Normally we use the variables area 2 and circumference 2. This is okay to pass by value. But in this case, you want the value to send it back to this subprogram as well. We will say it is a pass by reference. So it will be sent, it will send the address. So when you receive here in the function call here, you have to use ampersand and ampersand. Star area and star area. And you use star, this will be changed to star 2, star and star. So I will run program. See this carefully, run 5.4. And now the result in main program will be changed to 91.61 and 33.93. Okay. Okay, so this is a way that if you want to return two values into the function arguments like this, right? You may have to use ampersand for the caller. This one is a caller function. This one is a header or the receiver, right? This will be the area or the address of area and circumference and return the address of the area of the two area 2 and circumference 2. This is a way that I will write a program to pass by reference. I will start from pass by value first, and then I put ampersand for the caller. And for the callee, I will use asterisk every place of the variable that I would like to change the value inside the function, and then return the value back to the main function. Okay, this is what we call pass by reference. Okay, this might be I will show you another one, another example that is a swap. Swap function. Suppose I have integer num1, num2. Enter an integer and enter two integers. Okay. Num1 and num2. person type B. Okay. And print F. Two integers are okay. And I run. Oops. I forget to number one. And number three. Okay. There are two integers, right? 23 and 32. Okay, there are two integers printed out. Number one is 23 and number two is 32. Suppose I want to swap number one to number two, number two to number one. What shall I do? Can I use like this? Number one is equal to number two and number two is equal to number one. Can I do like this?
And then no, I ครับ.
What?
No, ครับ.
No, no. That is the correct answer. No, but I cannot do like this. Right? But I want to print it out. Try to print it out. If I write a program, right? It's supposed to. I know that someone for the first programming, right? For if you want to swap two integers, you will do like this. I'm quite sure. I write 1 1 and 2 2. Okay, and the result will be 2 2 and 2 2. What's happened? Because you swap or you assign 2 2 to number one, right? Because 2 2 is inside the number two, and then now number two is 20. Number one is 2 2, and then 2 2 will be replace to number two, so 2 2 and 2 2 will be printed out. So this one is incorrect. So what shall we do? So we shall have to use temp, right, to be the temporary value. So my tactic is move something to temp first. Move number one to temp, and then number two to number one, and then temp to number two. So it will be like a cyclic like this: temp number one, number one, number two, and temp. Do you get my point? Temp number one to number one here, number two, and then temp, and then I print out, run. So 1 1 and 2 2. So you swap already. So I want you to write a program. Before we will stop the class today, I want you to write a program void swap. Integer. Two integer num one and integer num two. Okay, write a program. Write a program like this function. Okay, before you leave, right? Okay, I will not use this one. I comment this one. I want to use swap number one, number two. And then I will print it out. Number one will be the value of number two, and number two will be the number of number one. Okay, write a program. That function. When you type the five into the chat box, right? It's not the class attendance checking, right? For the class attendance checking, maybe you have to type 7 Okay. If you want to check for the class attendance, please type 7 here into the chat box, and then I will count you for the class attendance. Now we have just only 73 something. Okay, while you are trying to write the program in order to solve for the swap two integers. So in this afternoon, you don't have to come to the class, okay? So maybe we'll show you the solution in the lab for this Friday, okay? But if you want to finish the lab 7, for the lab 7, right? If you have time in the afternoon, you can try to finish that, okay? No problem. I have already given you the lab 7 already. You can try to write a function in order to solve the problem. There are three or four questions, I'm not sure. Please try to do that in order to prove that you can understand the lesson today. Okay? Anyone in this room have finished the swap function? Can I copy here to there? Integer chain. Can I write this program like this? Integer chain. And I can also write integer chain and then do like this, or I write integer chain and then initialize it with num1. This is okay. Okay, maybe some students will write the program like this, so I will run first. 1, 1 and 2, 2. And the result remain the same. Why? Because num1 and num2 here will be sent to here, but it's not, it's just passed by value. This is passed by value. Okay, this is swap2, okay? I use this for swap2, this is a passed by value. But if you want to swap it, passed by reference, you can use swap here, fast by reference. Do you remember? What shall I do? I will have to use ampersand here, and then change num1 to star num1, star num2, star num1, star num2, star num1, star num2. Okay, this will be passed by reference. Anything has been changed in this function will be changed or affect to the value in the main function as well, which is a caller. Okay, then I run here. 1, 1 and 2, 2. Okay, two integer are swapped already. This is what we call pass by value or pass by reference. Okay, and that's all of today's lesson. Okay, do you have any question?